I don't think they can see the whiteboard line, but it'll do. I knew. Right. Is that the thumbnail? Is that what it is? I'll probably just get a picture of me absolutely dying squatting.
Yeah.
We're not the same height, aren't we? So from you and backwards, yeah.
But same height.
There we go. I'll out anger you. Right. Yes, people, welcome back to Brendan Pearson Fitness. Welcome back to Mic'd Up, episode 4, I think we're on now. Miss Adam Collard. We're going to be doing a bit of CrossFit today, I think. A bit of functional fitness. I haven't done anything like this for a while. So we're going to be squatting, but I'll let you walk through the session anyway.
So we're going to do some just strength and condition. We've got a lift, we've got a key performance lift for the day. We've got some accessory work for quality, and then we've got some conditioning. So essentially this is how most workouts will be structured. So the focus for today is the front squat. We're going to do a 5, a 5, a 5, a 3, a 3. Brendan was telling us that he hadn't front squatted in a while, and I thought, why not? And then we're going to do some quality reps, which is pretty much what you probably see Brendan do all the time anyway. So 3 to 4 sets of just a superset. Hamstrings going into quad and glute focus. So hamstring curls into barbell lunges. And then we're going to do some sweaty conditioning with a focus. And this is the point that I want to stress. The focus today is, because we're front squatted heavy here, the key performance lift in the Metcon is actually quite relatable, because there's going to be lighter front squats, which will then mean that Brendan will be super warm and it will probably be better for him, rather than say like this was a deadlift, or say deadlift could still be quite relatable, but say it was a push press, wouldn't really have anything to do with the specific Metcon. So yeah, so there's a key focus on some squats, some lunges, and getting out of breath. So we're gonna have some fun.
I will certainly be out of breath at the end of this. This is
gonna see what this goes like.
Kill me off. You've just came back from a competition. I'll get the excuses in for you. You've just done a competition at the weekend.
I'm remarkably sore. I'm just making sure this is working as well. I'm remarkably sore. Is that working?
Yeah, it should be on. Yeah. It's definitely on.
I'm remarkably sore, so don't take this as 100%. Take this as about 80%, but hopefully should be able to hold my own. We did the turf games, so you'll probably see some crazy clips, but yeah, give Brendan a little piece of that and see what he's like at the end. We've had loads of caffeine, so we're ready to go.
Yes.
And I've given him a 10-15 minute warm-up, but to be fair, Brendan's probably the only person that actually cares about a warm-up as much as me, so I'm pretty happy with
that. It's because we're just old, lanky, stiff. We need it.
Big, stiff idiots. Tyson Fury.
25, I know, bloody hell. Right. Get warmed up, let's go on. How long do your warm-ups normally take like this? Do you normally just spend 10, 15 minutes?
So what I normally do is, depending on what the session is, and obviously with it being, this is always like my Monday warm-up, because normally it's either always front squat, back squat, clean, something where you squat heavy. This is a banded hip distraction. And then just do like 2 rounds of like 30-30 either side.
Yeah.
I actually got this when I bulged my disc, and my disc was actually all to do with my hip.
Yeah.
Like my sacroiliac joint on my hip, which was pretty much just them saying like I had a bit of an imbalance in it, because it was my right side. So like this is nowhere near as bad as my right side.
Yeah.
So I normally do about like 5. I don't actually need a warm up. It's more mobility.
Yeah, it's just balancing things out, I find.
It's just getting in that right position. So normally this helps a lot. And then the next thing I'll do after 30-30 is banded pigeon. And then I think I did polygon step up.
Yeah.
Which is just a little knee over toes, just a little bit of that, which I know you love. And then just a, like one extra one for the lats, for especially for front squatting. Because like I find that like, especially if we're doing 5 sets, I don't actually feel really good until like the 3rd one if I don't do it properly.
Yeah.
Because especially with us having like long femurs and being tall, we need it a little bit more.
Yeah, it takes me a few sets to get into it. Especially lower body. Upper body I'm normally like a few sets and I'm in.
Yeah.
Lower body's just like, especially at the minute when I'm doing more bodybuilding stuff, I always do my isolations first, and that just kind of gives me a few more extra warm sets.
Primes you a little bit. Yeah, this has been an absolute game changer for me, this one. So like coming up, going into the pigeon, but like because this is pulling my hip back.
I'll give it a go. I've probably got too much of a heavy band, we'll see if I'm like it.
Yeah. It just like pulls us into the position, and then just do like 15, just trying to come to the floor, and every time I get that point, it sort of like releases your glute as well.
Yeah.
Which obviously we know how important that is. Do you know what?
It's shorter people can warm up quite quickly. It's those lanky lads who need a little bit longer to, and you've had a lot of injuries as well. It's just, I think it's one of them things where you're a taller lad and you've had a lot of injuries. You always need to take your time warming up. It's going to be one of those things.
For the sake of 10 minutes, right? Because you think about the average person in the gym as well, like in the in a sort of commercial gym, they're like going
to the gym. Oh, it does pull it back, to be fair.
Yeah. Feels amazing, that, doesn't it?
Oh, I've never done that. I do this every morning, but I've never done it with the band.
So I got it off at, I actually worked with an osteopath for quite a while, and this is what they gave me for like a little bit of rehab stuff.
It's my left one, that's normally tight on here.
Yeah.
That's the weird thing, my left hip, actually my right hip, sorry, is worse doing that, but my left hip's worse in like hip extension.
Yeah.
This is worse than the other way around.
I had a bit of a pop at everyone, not a pop, but like on Instagram, I put a warm-up routine. It wasn't a warm-up routine, it was a bit like this. And I said, if you've got a bad back and you're not willing to come in 3 minutes early to class, did you see it?
Come and do it, I haven't seen about
it. I put like four movements and I said, if you complain about a bad back and you're not willing to come in 3 minutes earlier and do three exercises for 30-30, this could save you, and it's your own fault you've got back pain.
I've had a client who's the exact same. Every time he comes in for a session, he has a bad back. Like he's got a daughter and she's not sleeping very well, so he's been sleeping in her bed and stuff.
Yeah.
And he's got an office-based job. He comes in, he's like, my back's aching again, my back's aching again. I'm like, right, we'll go and do, it's literally that stretch, but you put your back foot on the bench, get a little bit more rec fem.
Yeah.
Literally, we do that for 45 seconds each side. He's like, my back feels better. I was like, if you want to fix your back, you need to loosen your hips off more and try every half an hour to an hour, get up off your desk and just stand up and just stretch. Like, if you're in an office on your own, you can do that.
When I first crossed over from doing a bit more bodybuilding to a bit more functional fitness, I used to do the computer. I used to set two boxes up and have my back leg up in the couch stretch.
Yeah.
And then do the computer here. And
it makes a big difference, doesn't it?
Next thing I'll do is a little polygon step up, which you've probably done anyway.
Yeah.
I just do this literally, just six each leg twice. Don't even rest in between it. And it just gives us that little bit of comfort that if that patella is gonna go, it's hopefully gonna show us that it's gonna go now while I haven't got any weight through it, weight bearing through it, before it goes with a heavy barbell of like, I don't know, 100 kilos or something like that.
That's the one thing I found helped me, actually being able to squat pain-free on my toes, like just drop into a squat, literally just like that, like on my toes, like now I can do that. I never used to be able to do that.
Yeah, that was on my rehab program as well, you know?
Yeah. It's took us ages though, it's took us like a year, well, stopped football literally probably a year this month.
Was that your worst injury, your knees?
Knee and ankle.
Yeah.
I've had a full reconstruction on my right ankle, so that's the one thing that, like, my ankle mobility on my right side kills me.
So, next thing, just gonna do a Jefferson curl, especially for my lower back. You done that before?
It's where you really curl under, innit?
Yeah, so it's just again, trying to just feel the vertebra, each one. So obviously, do it for the camera. Not quite your regular deadlift. Complete opposite of everything you've just been taught. So I just think, try and imagine my spine in a picture.
Yeah.
One, each little vertebra coming and relaxing fully and going in a fully compromised position at the bottom, letting the bar roll forward and then nice and slow. And you literally only need one set of eight and then that's your route good to go.
Yeah. What did you say you had issues with your hammies?
My hammies feel tight off the weekend.
But yeah, all right. I wasn't sure if you had injuries or anything.
No. Everything to do with me is a little bit like right-sided. Like my right side is a bit weak.
Yeah.
And I think it's just because, so like I can feel my right glute and my right hamstring now, but that's just DOMS really.
Yeah.
It's just maybe a little pull from doing something, but nothing to worry about. It just feels amazing, this.
Oh, it does loosen your lower back off, like, doesn't it?
People could save themselves, like desk workers, just by doing like a few of these a day, couldn't they?
If there's one thing you would say that's helped you, like probably for your knee pain, or for knee and back pain, what would you say the one thing that's been the main? Or can you not really say it's one thing, you say it has to be a couple of things?
Knee and back pain.
Hip flexor stretch.
I can maybe give you two categories. One being releasing glutes and hip flexors.
Yeah.
So either the one where you, like what you did, I did it when you were in the toilets before, just like that.
Yeah, I like that one. Bar.
That would be my first category.
A lot of people cramp up in the hamstrings. I've had a few clients, hamstrings cramp like mad.
And then the second one is I had to do a lot of pull-off press, basically understanding how to contract and not contract, brace your core,
yeah,
intra-abdominal pressure while squatting.
Yeah.
Because what I was doing is I was like not breathing effectively, not and being flimsy here.
Yeah.
And then when I was coming down, I was like butt winking and just going soft.
Yeah.
Whereas like I'm actually thinking about like creating like intra-abdominal pressure.
Staying tight. Yeah, it's that, little bit of movement at the bottom, yeah, of the butt wing, isn't it, that a lot of people have in the hip shift and side. I see it with clients who have never squat before. They end up like putting the weight on one side and doing that.
Yeah.
So just adding in things like side planks and the dead bugs and stuff like that helps.
Right, I'm going to take this off.
I know, I think when people are just going straight into machine stuff, I think people should have some sort of foundation with like barbell stuff beforehand.
But then at the same time, and I was saying this on a video the other day, I actually think that one of the things that I'm quite good at CrossFit is pushing through lactic acid.
Yeah.
And I think that has came from doing bodybuilding and having like 20 rep leg press.
Yeah, high rep
because
stuff.
Because that's one thing that I find that like some people don't have when they've just started functional fitness.
They can't push the intensity to actual real failure. I think it works both ways though. I think a lot of people in bodybuilding, well, when they do bodybuilding, they don't actually push close enough. They're failing, they can't deal with intensity. But they're doing a lot of CrossFit workouts. When you're fucked, you have to push, you've constantly got to deal with that intensity rather than just being for a few reps.
Yeah.
It's like for like, rather than two reps, it's like two or three rounds that you're absolutely done in.
So try and sit at the bottom a little bit.
A little bit more.
Just for one set, just on the last rep. To get yourself really comfortable in that position.
Don't know whether to go wider or not. I'm always conscious of my knees coming in.
Yeah. No, that's cool. So yeah, as soon as you looked up there, your thoracic was much better. Hey, there's nothing wrong with that. No like platform or anything.
That doesn't feel too bad actually.
Yeah.
So it feels a bit better when you stick a bit of weight on.
Yeah.
Always feels a bit better. What's your goals then in terms of training? Is yours just
a bit
of fun or is it more you actually competing?
Sounds weird, but like, well, this year I said that what I want to do is I want to say yes to as many things as I can. So first one yesterday.
Yeah.
Compete in that CrossFit competition. March, doing one with the lads from here. Doing a triathlon for the first time ever.
Oh, nice.
I want to do an Ironman once in my life.
Yeah.
But that's not going to be now. But
you have to completely change your training, won't you?
Yeah, yeah. But saying that, I want to try and, like, I'm still just under 100. And if I can maintain that and maintain a bit of strength, like, my strength is not top end right now for me, but it's not far off. And
yeah.
I'm still doing a lot of other stuff. I'm swimming, like, once a week. I'm running once a week.
Yeah.
And then doing all the other stuff and, like, what we're doing, like, that 15-minute AMRAP at the end. You'll see, but I want to just be a weapon.
Just all rounder.
I
think a lot of people are switching to that now, aren't they? A lot of people want to do the all round sort of.
Someone said this the other day, it was like one of the young lads, he was like, oh, what's your best deadlift? Like, oh, what could you deadlift? And I was like, I don't know, maybe like 220 now. And he was like, oh, like he had a 230. And I was like, but I've deadlifted 240.
Yeah.
245, I think is my best deadlift. 240, definitely.
Yeah.
And he was like, but why can't you do that? And I said, because I can run 5K and in 3 seconds pick 200.
Do it up, yeah.
I said, I'm not, like, at that point when I did 240, I could do that, but, like, my fitness wasn't my goal then.
Yeah.
Like, right now, I can do both.
Do everything, yeah.
And it's, like, almost being, like, 80% at everything.
Uh-huh.
Right, let's see what this is like and decide whether it's a warm-up or a set.
You know when you first opened this place, were you doing bodybuilding any more stuff then, or was it more this?
I just started like crossing over the two.
Yeah.
Like, I would say I still really do functional bodybuilding.
Yeah.
Like, but I ramp it up when I want to, like, the last 6 weeks before that competition, I ramped it up a bit more. Like, the order of the structure would get different, so instead of doing strength, accessory, conditioning, strength, conditioning, accessory work, accessory
just
work.
Prioritizing different things at different
when it's second, it's actually really more bodybuilding work,
yeah,
which is cool, and that's what I want to do now. But when the focus is the condition, I put that first so I'm not fatigued, and then I'll do my lunges and my Nordics after.
Yeah, yeah, get what you mean. It's just prioritizing whatever you want to work on it.
Yeah, exactly.
Different. You know, back in the day when you were on Love Island, I remember seeing you doing like devil press thrusters and stuff, and I was thinking, what the fuck were you doing? With a lot of people, you know, when you're on there,
yeah.
Was that kind of like people thinking, what are you doing? Why is he doing that sort of thing? So it wasn't. I didn't really think it was. Like, I didn't really know about functional fitness, CrossFit and stuff. When was it? 2018. That was probably when it started to really get well known.
Yeah.
I think.
Yeah, I think like not trying to blow my own trumpet, but it was a lot bigger in.
That's your fun.
It's a lot bigger in America.
Yeah.
And like, there's a lot of CrossFit people, but like the way I want the gym run is like, I know that people aren't gonna like want to compete as much like what I do and stuff like that. But I want people to understand that there's more effective ways than like having to do morning cardio.
Yeah.
Like you can mix it with that. You're not gonna lose gains. Like.
Yeah.
You've done it as well. Like you've done.
I did it for
like
a good solid.
Yeah. And like people are like, oh, but you're a bodybuilder. You can't go on the assault bike. What's the difference with Stairmaster and assault bike?
Burning calories, isn't it? Yeah.
Your heart doesn't know if you're on one. You don't like automatically go from a bodybuilding category. But like, there's such a like stigma behind it.
Yeah.
And then people lose their mind when I mix stuff in, and I'm like, wait, we're gonna do chest and back.
Yeah.
Focus. I want you to control your dumbbell press, not bounce it off your chest.
Yeah.
But then you're gonna pair it with pull-ups in a row.
Yeah.
How does that work? And I'm like, well, what muscles are you using?
It's the same sort of thing.
If you can do 8 pull-ups after a 10 cal row,
yeah,
I guarantee your back will be more efficient than just doing pull-ups.
Yeah, it's working different things that people haven't done before. Like, yeah. You might find that some people will grow off it, just hitting different muscle fibers.
Exactly.
You get much better endorphin release as well. That's the one thing that we spoke about the last video. Just 100%. Like, you've done that push day and you're like, I feel like I need to do something now. That's the only thing, apart from on leg days, where you're like, you get that anyway. It's the only thing I feel like I really miss.
Exactly, dude.
So that's why I get carried away with my conditioning sometimes.
Right, come on, I'm going to video you on the phone as well. We've got all angles here.
Try not to see your hand in the air when you hear this and you drop off on your chair. Get your free on one like you don't care. I bust the note and show them you prepare. Just like I'm saying, I say that you know who's here. I let them know you want the best dance around here. Jump up on the dance floor when the record is up here. It's about to go off just like I don't care. Still, I'm going to see where this. Are you attempting to go back to full on bodybuilding? Do you think them kind of days are gone?
I want to, after the CrossFit Open's coming up, and I kind of want to be fit-ish just in case I want to do stuff like that. But
yeah.
I think I definitely want to go through a strength phase. So I wouldn't say
strong.
It's exactly like, I want to clean 140 once in my life.
Yeah.
And I want to snatch 100 once. And then like, just a couple of little goals like that. Yeah. It'd be nice to clean and jerk 140 just once, just to see.
I'd like to do some stuff like that. I've seen Craig, is it Craig Ritchie? Mate, that's his name. He's doing, it was powerlifting, it was Olympic lifting.
Olympic lifting.
He won his comp, didn't he?
Mate, obscene, you know. It's like unheard of that, to be that like fit at the same time.
Yeah.
Because obviously you just like got, you kind of was doing CrossFit sort of training.
Yeah.
But like no one realised, I think, for his weight, how strong he was for a while.
Yeah.
And then like, because he's like knocked obviously some of the condition on the head, he's just went 10
just
balls.
Focusing on it, he just flew up. I seen he won it, I didn't know what it was. It British finals, so was it like a pretty high?
British finals at 89 kilos, I think.
So yeah. For his first comp as well.
There's a guy who trains with quite a lot who I've met, he's on the knockout team as well, like
right.
Chris Murray, and he is mate,
ridiculous.
You watch him lift and it's just like actually awful, ridiculous. How well he moves the ball.
Yeah, I bet they don't use little heel wedges like this. Don't have granny ankles.
Oh. Your legs have got it.
Oh.
Yes, good.
Was death all right on that last one?
So, yeah.
All right-ish. Have you got any plans, like, content, social media-wise? Look, can you talk about the podcast or not?
Yeah.
When's that? When are you planning on starting that?
Obviously, hopefully, the podcast will be live in, let's see, what is it? It's the end of Jan.
This will probably be out in like
2 weeks.
I think 2 or 3 weeks, yeah, 2, maybe 3, because I think I'm going to take a weekend off this week.
So I've got a couple of weeks to pull my finger out, and obviously guest dependent, but I'm hoping that the podcast is going to be my next big thing.
Yeah.
I feel like it's the only missing piece of everything I do. I feel like my social media content over the last year has really stepped up.
Yeah.
Like, I'm very, very on top of the ball, and obviously I have missed a creative flow as well, helping us.
It does help.
But yeah, I just want to be, I always said this, like, I want to be like, I take a lot of inspiration from Marcus Philly, and I want to be like a UK version of him, in the sense of like, I like how he's like in the CrossFit himself, but like doesn't push it on his clients. He asks them what their goals are and uses tools from bodybuilding and CrossFit together.
Yeah, yeah.
That's my jam. Like, getting the average person, not the average person is an average, but getting the everyday athlete to feel as good, as big, as lean, and as fit as they can.
Yeah.
At the same time.
Just all around, having all around good physique, sort of thing.
Yeah. And just having fun as well.
Yeah.
That's like one of them, if you're not making sex noises, it's horrendous.
How have you found your social media-wise engagement since changing a lot of your content just purely fitness stuff, which I know is, you've talked about it in videos and stuff before.
Do you know what? It's not necessarily the change, I don't think. It's just harder now.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know about you, if you noticed, but
it's a lot.
The algorithms changes like every week, and like, you're sort of a bit like, bashing your head against the wall, being like, why is this changing?
Yeah.
I spoke to my agent about this last week, and I was like, this is kind of the reason why I want to do a podcast as well. Like, it's way harder to like
go
transfer views and transfer likes and like drive people to YouTube like this. Like, it is harder. Like, people think like, oh, you got like 900,000 plus followers or something like that, and you think, oh, straight away it's like a recipe for success. It's not like,
there's
like some people who like, and mine as well, like, this is the most frustrating one. I can do the best edit in the world with Joe, give out like the best advice to people, try and genuinely try and help people.
Yeah.
I'll get like no likes, no views.
Uh-huh.
And then I'll get a picture of me with no kit on my dog, and I'll get like 20,000 views.
It's stupid.
20,000 likes.
It's a lot of the YouTube stuff as well, because it's like 20-minute videos. People want like TikTok's all kind of big at the minute, because everyone wants the short, snappy stuff, whereas most of the good stuff's in the longer content. Who's some of your favourite people you're following at the minute, content-wise?
My favourite person who I follow at the minute?
Like, a few of them. Who do you reckon's going to level up? Like, people who are kind of relatively small, or maybe people going to kick off? Or even like athlete-wise, if there's any like people you know?
I think TM Cycles' new transition will be really interesting to see.
He's doing more functional than you thought.
Me, like, without trying to blow my own trumpet, when I did it, a lot of people were interested because they were like, Jesus Christ, if he's doing it and he now wants to do functional fitness, maybe I'll try it.
Yeah.
That was a big one. But I think his traction, because his followers are so bodybuilding oriented, will be a massive wake up call for
a lot of people. That's the thing with me doing bodybuilding at the minute. I feel like, I don't know if I was getting more, but I feel like, in terms of my business wise, I would be better suited doing the functional fitness sort of thing.
Yeah.
But for myself, I want to do the bodybilding just for a bit.
Different phase.
Yeah, I know, I'm doing it. That's the only thing, because I know. Getting massive, yeah, that's the idea.
I'm excited to see Josie this year.
Yeah.
And I'm being a bit biased because the missus, but like, people know that I'm going out for now, and she started seeing a little bit of traction from that.
Yeah.
And like, she qualifies as yoga this year. So, I'm very excited to see how that pans out.
Get the YouTube channel, podcast.
See if she gets the 10k mark.
That's the one. Once you hit that 10k, it helps a bit.
I think one of the things as well that a lot of people don't realise until going to competition this weekend and realising, like, people obviously think CrossFit, like, you're going to lose all your gains, but like,
yeah,
I'm still 99 kilos.
And, yeah.
Like, for me to get like the biggest I've got is 8, I think.
Yeah.
But that was full on like dirty bulk mode slash, not really dirty bulk, but I was fully not doing any conditioning.
Yeah.
But I think people think like you're gonna lose loads of weight, and honestly,
no. See, if you get the calories in, it's fine.
You're doing so much volume as well.
Yeah.
You're constantly overloading.
Yeah.
As you get fitter, you get more efficient at doing like more lunges. Get more efficient at doing more squats. More stuff like that.
I feel like that myth of getting like losing muscle when you're doing cardio is gone now, because if you look at CrossFitters, and they're all massive, they're all huge, but they're just thick as well.
It's volume.
Yeah.
Volume.
Just a different body type. Like thick, like midsection as well.
I like that as well, you know.
Yeah, they're kind of like when you lean back like that, it's just like dump, dump, dump.
Yeah. Great. Last set of lunges.
Yeah.
And then we're gonna fire it up.
Then we'll do.
Then we're gonna go.
Then I'm gonna die of lack of acid. Hey.
Lovely stuff. Because I can feel a little bit from yesterday, I'm not gonna lie.
Yeah.
We're gonna do wobbles instead of box overs, so there's less impact. Okay?
Yeah.
So, double unders, wobbles, 15 calorie assault bike. I'll tell you what we'll do. We'll do this. We'll aim to try and get around every 3 minutes.
Right. Here we go.
See what it's like.
Here we go.
See what he's
this
like.
Is the infamous YouTube series.
See what these single
me and Joe Rogan have got some competition. Maybe not. Let's see if I can even do one double under. See, I've never used these fancy skipping ropes before.
I know it might
I've got my Lonsdale ones in the garage.
I'm gonna put them.
See what?
These are at the missus's height, who is 5'2", I think. So I don't think this is quite gonna work at your height. So I'll put yours the same as mine.
Yeah.
I'll move off here. Yeah, you get the idea. Can I have a little go? See what you like.
Mm-hmm. Here we are. I'm no Mike Tyson, Mike. Here we go. Oh, one.
That's all right.
It's the second one. I don't know if I'm doing too many.
5 minutes later.
Yeah, your wrists need to move.
Faster.
Yeah. It's just your wrists, not your
Oh, that's way too tangled now. 3. Didn't lap us, I'm happy with that.
Yeah.
I'm happy you didn't lap us. I was literally thinking, halfway through them wall balls on like the third or fourth round, fucking CrossFit, I'm doing bodybuilding. I'm sticking to bodybuilding.
Yeah, it's wall balls take it out of a lot of people.
Yeah.
They get pretty frustrated about that.
My technique wasn't too bad. Oh. How much PT do you do now? Just little bits and bobs?
Like maybe like 10, 12 hours of like.
Yeah.
People who have had for years and might have supported us all the way through.
Yeah.
Stuff like that. But I still like training some of them. I've got like quite a good relationship. Some of them are like family, you know.
Yeah. That's what I'm finding now, like you've been with people for so long. They've kind of like met your family. Like, yeah. I met my mum and dad and stuff at like events and that.
That's what I mean.
They are kind of like family.
Yeah. But I still enjoy it. It still keeps us fresh. I use quite a lot of them if I need to for the online stuff. Like if I've got a woman who's doing split squats, it looks a bit more like it helps some of them like get their head around it. It's not just me doing these exercises.
That's what I'm wanting to try and do, like a client spotlight thing where I'm just showcasing some of my client sessions and then maybe just do like a little talk about like how I've helped them, what certain things they've been doing.
Yeah.
Just trying to make it like it's not just to be an athlete, it's like normal people just to feel good, look good sort of thing.
No, but definitely. It was a good session.
No, I enjoyed that, it was very good. So for the people listeners at home, what's a typical day in the life, Adam Collard, I mean, as a gym owner, because a lot of people, now know you as the fitness person rather than the whole Love Island thing, which I think that's kind of past now. What's a typical day in the life?
Typical day in the life is spinning a lot of plates, juggling a lot of stuff. I mean,
get up, pretty much do a little bit of mobility if I can. Maybe do my morning session as my cardio, so maybe do what we just did there, but at the start when I'm fresh, and then it allows us to just focus on my lifting later on. That would be like ideal for me, but sometimes it doesn't always happen. Sometimes I just do it like, we train for 1 hour 10 there, and that's more than enough, like 1 hour 15, I'd say. But get up, online check-ins, because obviously the academy, and obviously we have like challenges that run all the time with different online PTs and stuff like that. Make sure they're all boxed off first thing, come in, maybe train a couple of clients, have a little rest, train myself properly, as in like lifting and my actual program session for the day. Try and create content, whether it be for like Boohoo Man, or if it's just like a picture, like these tracks and trainers, Boohoo Man, Active, do a lot of that, or Knocko, or Barebells, or Gym King, or Primal Strength. They're all the brands that I work with, or Muscle Food. And then if I've not got that, I'll try and like set maybe an hour a day to just come up with videos for my Instagram, as in like, self-help, self-tutorial stuff, so like how to split squat without knee pain, I don't know, anything like that, and then go home and try and eat and try and have a social life as well.
So people think the life of a PT, especially gym owners, they'll probably just think it's like, oh, come in, open up, maybe do a good few classes, especially because you're the owner, you've got PT like coaches and stuff within the gym itself. People probably think maybe you just open up and just kind of take a few pictures on Instagram and stuff. It's not like that. Even as a PT, people think it's just training clients, but there's a lot of behind the scenes stuff, content creation, planning sessions. There's a lot more that goes into it.
I still do a Monday shift because I think that it sets the tone for the week. I always say that, but also it shows the customers when the gym is absolutely chocker like it is now, that like if he's still doing a Monday, he still actually cares. I still program all the classes, so I program every single class that's in Sculpt. Still have a few one-to-one clients who I absolutely love and I want to keep them, and have a few that are like just little projects, like I can be a little bit picky now, that's nice. And then there's a lot more work than what goes into Instagram than what people think. Don't get us wrong, I'm very lucky to be in this situation, but like there is a lot more work that goes into it, with brands and stuff like that. For one little edit that you see or one picture, it's probably been taken 1,000 times and it's been denied. So it can be harder work than what you think, but I'm loving it. I could definitely just open the gym up, sit there, take a couple of Instagram pictures and be comfortable. But like, I'm hungry, like, school.
This is your life, and this is what you enjoy doing. Because I think a lot of people, especially the ones who are in the kind of social media, fame, reality TV sort of thing, they do the reality TV, but they've got nothing outside of it.
Yeah.
Whereas you already have that plan, and you're like, you see, like, well, obviously, Money Way, the thing that happened at the minute, it's a different story. But beforehand, she was already kind of in that business sort of mindset before she went on the show, and then afterwards she's built something. Where a lot of people go on, do the adverts, do the little bits and bobs, and then they kind of don't have anything to fall back on.
Yeah.
Whereas you had a business to grow on, and you're not doing as much reality TV, that sort of stuff now, which a lot of people can't go into, which is fine, but you've got that life because you love fitness, you love being a gym owner, you love training people. Like, people probably think, oh, what's Adam Cotter? Obviously, he's still got a very good following, but he's not in the limelight as much now, but you're doing what you love, and kind of you've built a bit of business and a lifestyle that you enjoy, so.
Yeah.
Fair play to you for that one.
Nice, thanks for having me. Thanks for mic
up. Very good.
I will get to a bodybuilding gym soon.
Ultra Flex, Adam Collard, destroy him. That was very good. Get some more session in. I know, I'm knackered after that. Gonna go home, get some food, train some clients later on. Nice. Standard day in our life, very good.
Until remember, the next one.
I know, like, subscribe, all that good stuff, and I'll see you in the next video. Hold the light and spark the fear. Candidate people, not the parties over here. Half price, and yes, the bad welfare too. Pound a shot, I wanna pound